All right, welcome everyone. We'll have, we have some people in the waiting room still, and we'll be getting started in just a moment. So I have a few little housekeeping details that I wanna share as we're getting settled in here. And I wanna welcome you all to our last season of Design in a Post-Pandemic World. So we're meeting today during Ethics Week at the university. So the topic is timely and we have a nice group of people expected to join us. So thanks again for coming, and we'll start to move along here. My name is Lori Mulberg. I'm the Director of Alumni Relations for the College of Design, and I'll be hanging out in the background and administering our breakout rooms. And if you need any assistance during the session, you're welcome to chat with me and or one of our hosts. So as you heard, our meeting is being recorded. And if you have questions at any time during the session, feel free to enter them into chat. And Abby will be monitoring our chat feed today, and she'll pull out questions as at the appropriate times during the session. So anytime you think of something, feel free to drop it in there and we will get to that. For those of you who are interested, the session is available through one AIA learning unit or a certificate if you'd like that for your files. And so if you happen to have mentioned that when you registered, I'll take care of that and you should see a message from me with your certificate within a week of the event typically. And if you didn't sign up for that or ask for that when you registered, but you're interested, I'll send out an email right after the event and then you are welcome to just reply and let me know. And I'll make sure you get that. So with that, I'd like to introduce our series hosts, Abby Asojo, Tom Fisher, and Virajita Singh. Abby is our Associate Dean for Research, and she's also the Professor of Interior Design. And Tom is our Director of the Minnesota Design Center and former Dean of the College of Design. And Virajita is a Senior Research Associate with the Center for Spirituality, not the Center for the Center for Sustainable Building Research. I'm thinking about an upcoming series, and also our Associate Vice Provost for the Office of Equity and Diversity. So our panelists today include Tom and Virajita, and also Al Levine, who is a Professor Emeritus at the U, former Dean of the College of Ag, Food, and Environmental Sciences, and a former Vice President at the University. So he'll have a lot to share about ethical dilemmas in academics. And so with that, I'm going to hand this over to Abby to give us a little intro to the series and our agenda.
Thank you, Lori. Welcome, everyone. So the Design in a Post-Pandemic World is a session that came about when the pandemic hit. And we used the forum to come together to talk about what we're experiencing during this global disruption. And we're using the sessions also to co-imagine what our post-pandemic future can look like. And we're using design to identify ways to support positive change through new types of collaborations and design solutions. And we also want to spark new ways of thinking about design in our lives and organizations. The other thing I wanted to say today too is this week is the Research Ethics Week at the university. And this session is one of the sessions that is ongoing as a result of the Ethics Week at the University of Minnesota. So welcome everyone. So just to give you like a overview, I posted the bios of our speakers into chat, so you could click on that and learn more about our speakers. Tom is going to give like a topic overview shortly, and then there'll be a dialogue session with Virajita and Al Levine, and after which we'll go into small group discussions, and we'll be in the small group discussions in the breakout room for about 20 minutes. We'll post some questions into chat, and we'll also share like a note-taking slide where you collaborate together. And then when we come back around 3:40, each group member, maybe each group should select someone to report back to the group, to the whole group. And after each group reports, we'll have some closing remarks and the program will end. So that's just the general overview of our session today. So I'll hand it over to Tom to give the topic introduction.
Great. Thank you, Abby. And thanks everybody for coming. So as Abby said, I'm Tom Fisher. I used to be the Dean of the College of Design and one of the three panelists, all of whom have academic administrative experience. Although I want to make the point right at the beginning that the ethical dilemmas that we're going to talk about that we encountered in the process of being academic leaders are very parallel to the issues that the heads of any business organization, any design firm also faces, that these are ethical dilemmas that come with leadership and that are part of dealing with complex organizations. So as you talk in your breakout rooms about these issues, we really encourage you all to bring your own experiences in whatever work that you've done to this conversation. So the other thing about this is that we're in this kind of post-pandemic world or soon to be post-pandemic world. I have a book coming out at the end of April on this topic. And the issues that have been raised by the pandemic also raise all kinds of ethical dilemmas. And so one of the things that we wanted to talk about today was what are some of those and how might we start to think about them? I mean, the issue about ethics, and just to give you a kind of very brief overview of that topic, is that it is it pertains to situations where there are seemingly not any good answers, or at least there are dilemmas where maybe there are multiple goods that are in conflict. And so ethics really arises when we're trying to figure out what is the right thing to do in a given situation when the answer to that isn't obvious. And in that sense, ethics is a little different from the law, which often the law is pretty clear about what's legal and what is illegal. Ethics is this much broader area where it's not about breaking a law, but it's about not being sure what the right action is. And that is a particularly modern question. I mean, in the history of ethics, the ancient ethics, the ethics of the Greeks and the Romans, for example, or of other non-Western countries, there was much more of a focus on being a good person, that the focus was on character. And we sometimes call that virtue ethics, how to be a virtuous person. And that is still, of course, important. And there's been, in fact, a revived interest in the idea of virtue ethics, but that's the idea of it was that if you're a good person, then you will act in good ways. There was also another tradition of ethics, which was about what creating a good society. In other words, this idea that we do good actions when we're in a community or in a society that rewards us for doing good things and punishes us if we don't. This was called social contract ethics, and there's a long history of that. And in fact, a lot of the political debates we have in this country are between those who put a lot of emphasis on individual actions, on being a good person, versus those who say, yes, but even a good people can go bad if the environment around them is corrupting or if they're been disadvantaged in some way. And so that ancient debate in ethics between a good person and being a good society continues in our own politics today. However, in more recent centuries, certainly in the West, the focus has been more on actions. So less about being good and more about doing good. And how do we decide what's the good thing to do in a situation? And in that regard, there's really sort of two big areas of thinking about this. One is focused on your intentions. And this was something that Immanuel Kant, the philosopher, strongly argued, which is you should focus on having the right intentions. You will do the right thing if you have good intentions, and that you should do the right thing regardless of the consequences. And so he argued that we all know what the right thing is. We sometimes don't do the right thing because of self-interest or personal gain. There are all sorts of reasons why we don't choose the right course. But he argued that most of us know the right thing to do in a situation. And then the other big area, and we'll probably talk more about that throughout the webinar today, is this idea of your intentions don't matter if the consequences are bad. And so this is called by various names, consequentialism, it's utilitarianism, pragmatism is another term that's often used for this, which is to focus on the consequences of your decisions. And did a decision result in the greatest good for the greatest number, as Jeremy Bentham would say? And so that is probably the predominant kind of ethical position in a kind of market-based capitalistic world, such as the one most of us are in. And it is also, I think, the kinds of ethics that a lot of leaders, be they the leaders in academic organizations or the leaders of a business or a professional firm, have to deal with. We have to pay attention to the consequences of our decisions. Now, that is often easier said than done, because frequently it raises all sorts of other issues, like the consequences for whom. The old idea of the greatest good for the greatest number frequently didn't account for a lot of underrepresented groups, groups who were in a minority. And so you could argue that utilitarianism is a kind of the tyranny of the majority over minority points of view or minority communities. And so there's been, I think, a shift in certainly in recent decades to say that you have to attend to the consequences on everybody, not simply on the majority, not simply for those who are in power, but for you also have to pay attention to the effects of your decisions on people who aren't at the table, people who are underrepresented, people who have minority points of view, for example. And so that there's been this kind of shift, and I think that's certainly something we've sensed in our academic leadership, is that in many ways we almost have to very consciously attend to the needs of those who don't have a voice. There's a particular thinker named John Rawls who had an interesting idea related to this. He said, imagine there was every decision you made was behind what he called a veil of ignorance, which his idea was is that, you know, you wouldn't know who was the most and least advantaged person in making a decision. And he argued that if you didn't know that, you would always make a decision that ensured that the least advantaged person was not disadvantaged, that there was some benefit to everybody. And that, I think, has been a sort of approach to consequentialist ethics that, again, has become a much more dominant strain in recent decades, as we make sure that every decision doesn't further disadvantage people who are already disadvantaged, and in fact is trying to bring everybody up and to attend to the needs of as many people as possible. I'll just maybe say one more thing about the kind of moment that we're in right now. I mean, we're all obviously aware of what's going on in Russia and Ukraine right now. And I think it gives some good examples of the sources of unethical behavior. So there are frequently three areas of that lead people to not do the right thing, as Kant would say. One of them is, are you too isolated in your perspective, in your point of view? I mean, you could argue that Vladimir Putin has a bunch of people around him who are just telling him what he wants to hear. And that's, of course, a problem in any leadership position. You can be in the head of a business or a head of a design firm, head of a college, and have the same phenomenon that everyone around you is a yes person, and actually leads you to have a distorted point of view about what is the right thing to do. And so one of the ways to get around this is to say that it's important to have conversations with as many diverse people as possible, to get as many different points of view. And what's important here, and I talk about this in the three books I've written about ethics, it's really important to see ethics as the beginning of a conversation with others. In other words, not to think that you or any of us has to always know what the right thing is to do, that frequently by having these kind of conversations of the sort that we're going to have today helps us figure out what is the right thing to do. So talk about ethics with others, and bring your ethical dilemmas to other people, as Putin is not, and you will frequently end up probably having better results. Another driver of unethical behavior is self-interest, that you, you're putting too much of your own interests above others. And again, one of the aspects we certainly see with Putin, he's not thinking about the Ukrainians, right? And so here, this is this John Rawls idea of when you think about the consequences, pay extra attention to the people who don't have power, who don't have a voice, and make sure that you're not disadvantaging them out of your own self-interest. And then finally, a third driver of unethical behavior is frequently a short-term point of view, thinking not only about your self-interest, but over the short term rather than long-term thinking. And so another aspect of dealing with ethics is to think about the long-term consequences of a decision. And this, of course, is also a challenge for leaders because we have a lot of incentives to be to make decisions based on the current pressures on us. And there's usually time pressures, and there are interested parties who are putting pressure on us to decide one way or another. And one of the roles of leadership, I think, is to keep the long-term interests of as many different people as possible in mind, and to be looking out ahead to think about what the unforeseen consequences might be, rather than just the things that you can anticipate now. So we thought we'd have a conversation among the three of us, and in addition to myself, as Abby said, we're really fortunate to have Al Levine, my former colleague, a fellow dean. He was the dean of the College of Food. CFANS, Food, Agricultural, and Natural Resource Sciences. Yes, thank you, Al. And as well as having a couple different positions in upper administration as VP of research and also in the associate provost for faculty and academic affairs. And then my long-term colleague from the College of Design, Virajita Singh, who in addition to all of the great work that she's done in the Center for Sustainable Building Research and in teaching, she's been in the Office of Equity and Diversity at the university. And for those who may not know, she's just about to take a new position at the Minneapolis Institute of Arts as their new chief equity and inclusion officer. Did I get that right, Virajita?
Diversity and inclusion.
Diversity and inclusion officer. Yeah, a new position that she will be starting. So it will be fun to hear from the two of them. And then after we get done with our conversation, we'll go into breakout rooms. There are four different questions that we've asked each group to pick one and to talk about, and then we'll get back together and report out on your conversation. So maybe with that, I'll turn to, let's see, Al, are you next or Virajita? Is that out of
which order?
Yeah. Okay, Al, you're on. Thanks.
So thanks, Tom. So relevant to what Tom was talking about, a lot of administrative positions are really decision-making positions. So I'll start out just telling you some simple things around being a dean of a school that primarily does agriculture, but also has environmental sciences. So you have the people who cut down trees and you have the people who hug the trees. You have different opinions. You have the environmental scientists who don't want to use a lot of chemicals and the agricultural ones who want to use chemicals for productivity issues. So to give you an example of the kinds of things that happen when you're a dean, some are simple. So doing what Kant said, doing the right thing is not too tough when you have, for example, I had a major donor come up to me and say, I want my granddaughter to get into your college. Well, that's a pretty simple one. I'm not going to admit somebody unless they're qualified into my college. I might lose that donor's donation, but it's unlikely that would happen anyway. And thankfully, in that circumstance, I didn't say anything to her. And the next thing I know, I was told that her granddaughter was admitted, so I was safe. But here's another situation. So when you're a dean of an ag school in a state that has so much agricultural economics involved, you really represent the farmers in the community as well as the academic community. And so I was faced with a dilemma that the Bell Museum of Natural History reported to me in our college, and they had produced a film called Troubled Waters, and it was a history of the Mississippi River and the Dead Zone. And when I watched that movie the first time, I said, uh-oh, They're blaming ag guys, all the farmers, for all the destruction of the river and causing the dead zone. So I showed it to a number of my colleagues in the ag school and other administrators, and they said, uh-oh, we got a problem here. So I just decided that I would tell the president of the university and his associate he was going to introduce this film at the Bell Museum on its premiere. And all I did was say, you know, just be wary. There may be some people from the agricultural community who might not be happy with the fact that the university produced this film. And the next day, somebody came in my office and said that the vice president for public affairs had pulled that film from TPT. They were going to show it on public TV. And you can only imagine the faculty going crazy and saying, this is censorship. And my name was in the newspaper virtually every day for 3 weeks because I was interviewed by NPR, and all that I said was the opening of the film vilified agriculture. And the headline from NPR was, Levine pulled the film because it vilified agriculture. I never pulled the film. And we had about a month of dilemmas dealing with faculty and the provost's office, and it all got settled at the end. And it was shown and there were no problems, but that's just the kind of dilemma you face. I was trying to do the right thing for the community to just inform the president. But by doing so, I got myself and some others into a great deal of trouble over this, and I'm still taking drugs from the anxiety that caused. So that was one of the kinds of problems that I faced during the time as a dean. Now, as a vice president for research, and also I was at the VA Medical Center for 27 years, and for about 16 of those years, I co-directed research. You can imagine the kinds of things that go on when you have animal studies and you have human trials. And so under those circumstances, you try to make the right decision, but I can remember a time where we had, quote unquote, punished an investigator for not doing something exactly right in a human trial. And I got a call from an administrator, a senior administrator, who said, you know, you're going to ruin that person's career. So you have to pull that letter so it doesn't go to the federal government to tell what happened. And I said, I can't do that. That's the Human Studies Committee, the IRB, that takes care of that issue. So that I was getting pressure to try to pull that letter. And of course, we couldn't do that. The other thing is with animal studies, there's a lot of feelings around animal studies. It's pretty easy to understand the issues around primate studies. But when you're dealing with mice and rats, and you have a study with 400 rats or 400 mice and people are complaining. So then you have the PETA organizations and the others that are constantly on your back, and you have to decide what the right thing to do is. So that whole decision-making that you do around deontology or utilitarianism, in some cases, it's easy. If you know a murderer is coming to your door and wants to kill your kid, you're not going to do the right thing if the kid's hiding in the closet and say, he's in the closet. That's easy because the consequences are overwhelming. But there are times where you choose to do, as Kant would say, the proper thing. So I think those are just some examples I wanted to give you around the topic that Tom was talking about. And as he said, it doesn't matter what kind of leadership position you hold. These decision-making processes occur regularly in government, in private industry, in academia. So at this point, I'll turn it over to Virajita for her comments.
Yeah, great. Thanks, Al. Virajita.
Thank you. And I see a comment about from Regina about as Al was talking about industrial agriculture as a whole. Well, I think with the university, many different constituents are represented here, and there are these, sort of tensions, but also points of synthesis and navigation. So I think it's a very rich environment, and some of that might come in our conversation. Thank you, Tom and Al, for introducing the idea in much depth. I'm just going to say that, personally practicing sort of ethics in a university context, I have realized that, there is the personal ethics and values one holds, but then there is the unit you represent and the values, and of course, of the larger university. So there's almost like concentric circles, and then there's the world of policies that kind of hold us to certain ethics, which may be actually outdated. In fact, in my work with equity and diversity, there's a wonderful committee, the Equity Lens Policy Review Committee, that's part of the diversity community of practice that has just reviewed 207 of university policies on the president's request, President Gabel's request, through an equity lens, you know. So I think there's all of these things are forming, but sometimes they're locked into our system and then put us in unethical positions possibly. So I'll just use a quick example from my work in the College of Design, leading the Design for Community Resilience, which involved working with communities, often very small communities in Minnesota. And specifically one instance was when I was working with a small community in Minnesota, and we were working on a potential plaza design project. And in some ways it was becoming more and more inclusive. We were addressing people with disabilities and all of that, and it was going really well until we got to the point where we had to, the community was trying to pick a site for basically, you know, locating that plaza. And I got this strange request, which was strange because I had not experienced it before, which is that the community had decided on a site, but they wanted me to keep it secret. And the reason was very well intentioned, because as soon as you declared the site, the real estate prices on that site would skyrocket, making it thus unaffordable to the community to invest in. So that made sense. But my dilemma was that, practically speaking, in a community that has a main street of four blocks, how do you actually show a site and then keep it anonymous? That's one practical reason. But the second is that from a university standpoint, our commitment to public engagement and transparency and all of that is so deep that it didn't make sense to do that either also, as it was like keeping things under wraps that didn't seem appropriate. So as Tom mentioned earlier, it's ethics is a point of starting point for a conversation. And so that's how I explored it. And I explained what the dilemma was both to the community clients, but also our partners, which was another extension unit. And essentially what we figured out is the only way I could treat the project and not reveal a site was to then make it a design exercise of actually developing a prototype design for plazas that could be used in any site across the community. And so by doing that, I felt like I was walking the line of being ethical to generating ideas that would be useful to the community, but not lying about sort of that, you know, that we didn't know what the site was and so on. And then making it truly a generic programmatic design that would apply to multiple sites in case that went forward. And we seemed to come to the consensus that seemed like a good solution. And I think there the ethics for me was not only the transparency and all of that I felt embodied the university's approach to this, but was also the maintaining and communicating to transparency in the communication about this ethical dilemma, but also maintaining relationships with the community, because that's also an important value of the university while working in our greater Minnesota, you know, context. So I'll stop there, but it would be great to have a conversation. We have, I think, 5 or 6 more minutes. So if people have questions for us.
Well, there have been some that have come both now as well as before. And I just also wanted to just pick up on the idea of some of the ethical dilemmas that this pandemic has created for us. For example, a decision about whether your employees should be wearing masks or not, when some people might in fact still be very medically or physically vulnerable to catching COVID-19, while others are feeling that it's somehow an inhibition on their freedom, their personal freedom. This is something that universities are and organizations all over are dealing with. At what point do you lift a mask mandate or not? The university, for example, still has a mask mandate in place for all interior spaces. So, you know, there are those issues. There are issues related that the pandemic has brought up related to what it means to be an employee and where you work. Some of you may know that in Hennepin County, the recently hired director of the library was basically asked to resign or decided to resign because he worked and lived in Los Angeles and didn't plan to move to Minneapolis, made the case that he could do his work remotely. But this was viewed by others in the library system that, you know, he's not really committed or he needs to be here if we're going to be here. And so this issue of, does an employee need to be physically present anymore when you can do a lot of your work remotely? And how do you balance that? How do you sort of think about what's fair for those who come to work physically every day and those who stay remote? How do we balance this issue between those in essential, so-called essential work that requires in-person interaction and those who can be totally remote in their activities? So those are some of the and the dilemmas go on. The vaccines, is it a right for somebody to, you know, not take a vaccine when others say that, well, by not taking those vaccines, you're actually enabling variants of COVID to develop, and so that endangers the whole community. So these dilemmas about what's in your own personal interest versus the larger good is a kind of core ethical dilemma that leaders deal with. Leaders deal with the ethical dilemmas of timing. You know, at what point do you make a decision? Sometimes a decision can be made too early, or sometimes it can be made too late. This balance that this pandemic has created between what do we do in person and what do we do remotely? And for those of us who are involved in the design of the physical environment, that's a key question, which is, you know, what are people going to do in offices in the future? Why come to an office if you can work remotely? Why go to a store if you can shop online? Why go to a classroom if the course can be delivered remotely? So that conversation also has all kinds of ethical dilemmas in it. Al.
I thought I'd also mention that while I was the vice provost for faculty and academic affairs, I came to really realize the importance of tenure. And when you see these comments, like somebody saying the agriculture has a hold on academia, maybe on the administrators to some degree, but not on the faculty. That's why they have tenure. Mm-hmm. So if they don't want to go along with an issue that they're getting pressure from specific organizations, that's the protection of university freedom because of tenure. Now, we know tenure can be abused. I mean, we had somebody who was in prison who wanted to teach from prison because they were tenured and didn't want to have their tenure removed. That's the extreme. But there are states now where the governors and others are trying to eliminate tenure from their public universities. So I think I wanted to point that out because it's always a question of how can you have a lifetime employment guaranteed? And the main reason that tenure was ever established was because of that. So public, especially in public universities, or public pressure, but in privates as well, because donors can put immense pressure on one for that kind of thing.
Yeah. And Steve Kelly has an interesting question in the chat about, you know, how has design influenced our thought processes around ethical dilemmas, which is a great question. I think that the way I think about design, it's trying to find in ways to overcome conflicts. So I think one of the reasons I got interested in ethics was because it's frequently viewed in these sort of irresolvable conflicts. And I'm always, as a designer, trying to think about, okay, what's the alternative where you can find win-win solutions rather than win-lose solutions? And then also this idea of co-creating, of involving more people in the conversation, with the idea that there's a kind of wisdom of the crowd that you hear a lot of different points of view. Frequently, the right thing sort of emerges out of a process of engaging other people in it. But Virajita, how would you respond to that?
I'd love to add. Great question, Steve. So I think one of the issues is often, you know, we get into this either or thinking when we see the dilemma from a certain perspective, but design actually has the skills of synthesis built in. So you look at the, you know, different parts of a situation, you know, a problem, and then you synthesize across it and get to some higher order thinking that brings the needs and solutions together, you know. And so that kind of thinking is really, really useful because there isn't, it's not always always either or black and white, you know. It's sort of, we get to a different scale of solution making. And as Tom mentioned, you know, you can actually engage more people in the process in the best case scenario. That doesn't always happen, I admit, in design projects, but then you're actually, not only do you get to a solution that would make more sense and impact more people, but you have more buy-in and ownership to that too. So I think there are certain things that design brings. And Steve, thank you for always asking those questions and bringing that design-centric perspective too.
You know, another thing that comes to mind is designers are taught to think of issues at different scales. And I find that sometimes with an ethical dilemma is that when you look at the problem from another scale, there's, you know, you'll find other solutions or other connections that maybe you didn't see at the scale of the problem itself. Frequently, the solution is at another level. And I've always found that ability to go from the smallest scale up to the largest scale and back again, which is sort of what we're taught to do as designers, has helped in, you know, sort of addressing ethical dilemmas.
Yeah, and speaking of the design, mm-hmm. When we talk about remote learning, one of the difficulties I had not only with learning, but collegial engagement is I managed and led by walking the halls. Mm-hmm. I can't walk the halls if everything is remote. Yep. And, you know, you would just poke, you know, you peek into somebody's office and ask them a question. How do you do that? So design has to come up with something to deal with this if we're going to use remote learning and exchange.
Right. Yeah.
And some people, there are programs that do that, but you have to have your cameras on all the time, essentially, and it's intrusive.
Yeah. And it's so interesting, Al, because there are definitely things we've lost in interacting remotely, but then there are things we've gained, right? This ability for, you know, students from around the world to log into a class, our ability to bring speakers from around the world to talk to our students that would never could have happened if they had to physically travel. So I think the next many years are going to be our sorting out what is the best thing to do given a need, and how do we use both the digital and physical world to do the right thing?
So I wonder if Abby wanted to take us to the next step. I was realizing that time is flying.
Yes. Thank you so much, Al, Virajita, and Tom. Great discussions. So the next agenda is we're going to go into breakout rooms, and there are four questions that you tackle in the breakout room. And I'm just going to really quickly post into chat the note-taking slides. Get into the breakout room, identify a representative, right? And then the representative will capture the key ideas in the note-taking slides that I posted in chat. And I mean, introduce yourself briefly, and everyone is encouraged to participate. So Laurie will take us to breakout room right now. There are four questions you're going to consider. You know, each group is welcome to pick any of the four. Just consider one, because they are really, I mean, there are lots of ethical challenges on the questions. The first one has to do with a controversial speaker is invited to give a presentation on campus. And some students, how would you handle the situation? And thanks, Virajita, she's posting it into chat. And then there's another one about buildings on campus. And then Laurie, if you could transition to the next slide. It's about the example Tom also mentioned earlier on, a unit, Isaiah, the director, wants to work remotely from another state. So how would you handle that situation? And then the fourth one has to do with a work of art that was commissioned and was considered inappropriate and discriminatory. So, you know, those are the four ethical dilemmas that you're going to consider in the breakout room. And they're posted into chat. So if you want to grab it and take it along with you, I will also post again the note-taking slide. If you just click on that, you'll be able to take notes on the slides too.
Yeah, just to clarify, you can you need to only pick one of them because we won't have enough time, you know, for all the four.
Yes, only one question per breakout room, and you're welcome to pick which one you want to consider, as we mentioned earlier on. Thank you.
So I'm going to go ahead and open the breakout rooms now, and you can find these questions written out in the first couple of pages of the note-taking slides if you want to refer back to them in that way as well. So here you go. We have just a moment here as people start to return from their breakout rooms, and we'll get back to the conversation.
Yes.
Great.
Welcome back, everyone. I think maybe we might have everyone back now. So in each of the groups, you might have identified who's going to report back. So I'll just go ahead and call on the groups to have you summarize what question you picked and give us some feedback. So group one, I'm going to go ahead and call group one. Thanks, Lori, for sharing. So is there someone who wants to speak up for group one and summarize your discussion?
I guess I can do it. I took notes. So we chose situation number one where the someone would be working remote and a director, I think it was, for whatever it is. I lost it. Oh no, number three, your unit has hired a director who worked remotely from another state. So we talked about losing personal connections and how, you know, we talked about the library director in Minneapolis that was working from California, and apparently it enraged the people who worked under him, the fact that he was working remotely. We talked about moving forward, you know, should people return to work full time or continue to work from home, and how best do you serve your customers, you know, to really think about your customer and how you would, you know, how each of these situations would work best. And, you know, that I brought up that I felt like if the library director isn't here personally, working with his staff, how does he know how his customers are, how the customer service works? We talked about how Tim had staff who would come to his office occasionally and pick up their work and go back to their homes and work, and then they would not get together for a while again. And when they did, they realized that they were had gone off in a direction that was not the direction that was intended. So that if they had all been in the office, it would have been, they would have been communicating more effectively. We talked about the job being part of a community, that we learn from each other. In the school setting especially, they learned as much from fellow students as from teachers, and there was collaboration. And then we talked about wondering what the future in our kids with cell phones and not sharing information with each other except via cell phone and texting and so on. But we all could understand why people would like to work from home, and at some times people were able to be much more productive at home, but then, you know, they're at this point really feeling like they need that personal connection. And also talking about that buildings are going vacant and what is going to become of office space, just the overall societal aspect of, you know, talking on the telephone, writing an email, that sometimes the message gets lost. And then we talked about leading by example and the fact that how we talked about the president of Ukraine and how he's leading by example and how, you know, how important that is right now to them. And Ben, do you have things to add, or anybody from our group?
We can move to the next group if. Thank you, Deborah.
Yep.
Group two. I don't see any notes on group two, so I wonder if anyone wants to speak up for group two. Okay, Maureen, thank you. You're muted.
Yeah, I was muted, sorry about that. We chose the same question, and we looked at it also from not only the director not wanting to come to the campus, but what we're currently addressing as instructors, students not wanting to come back to the classroom, and some of those issues as well. So some of the points that we came up with is that those that have the obligation to be on campus due to their job role, their physical responsibilities with their job might be a little resentful, or it could cause strain when other people have the flexibility to be on campus or off campus. From the instructor's point of view, when we were remote and it wasn't a choice, we figured it out. But now that we have come back to the classroom, we do get some pushback from students who don't understand, well, we were remote before, why can't we be remote again? Or if I don't want to come in, why can't I just Zoom into class? So now that they know that there's another option, they want more control over how they participate in class instead of being told you have to be here. Another point that was brought up is, and so it's like, but at the same time, why should everybody have to do the same thing? If he can work remotely successfully, why not? And then we had a little laugh about the terms of his contract. If it wasn't designated in his contract that he was on site, he now has a valid contractual argument to stay remote. So it would have to be, is he fulfilling the terms of his contract? But what wouldn't be addressed in his contract is how his direct reports are being supported by him. Is he giving them the kind of leadership that his staff needs if he is not on site? Another thing we talked about quite a bit was those water cooler moments, those incidental learning opportunities that are lost because online or remote interactions are planned or scripted They're not organic. And some people, but some people do interact better online because it is planned. And how we might need to consider what kind of work is appropriate or better delivered on site or in person versus, well, what could we really do remotely? A couple people mentioned the opportunity to bring in guest speakers, or I think that came up earlier, is, you know, the opportunity to broaden our net for those interactions, because if we could only do them on site, we would lose those opportunities. Let's see. Another person brought up that some of this was age dependent, how, you know, we used to gather after work to kind of talk shop, and we don't really do that anymore. But can we still do that remotely? And those interactions, those interpersonal relationships that we build through community, and if that can be established, or is it as effective if we're doing all this kind of personal relationships, personal interactions, if it's only done remotely.
Thank you, Maureen. If we can move to group three.
Yes, so we chose the scenario where of renaming a university building, and I think going into it, what a lot of us were thinking, you know, it seems pretty obvious why we would be wanting to rename buildings at this point. But the, you know, counterpoints to that might be, are you erasing a part of history and thereby perhaps sanitizing it if you rename a project? And if by doing so, are you setting up conditions where people might forget the reason that you don't want it named after the group or family or person anymore after that time? Thinking about the example of Lake Calhoun and Bede Makaska. But then an interesting point was brought up, you know, the building could be renamed for something in the same vein of the same issue, but for something we want to honor or a person we want to honor in doing the work of undoing the legacy of the Calhoun family, for example. And, you know, you could tell the history of that and not lose the history. And then the question of whether a new name would be unacceptable because values change over time, and this idea that of almost kind of abdicating responsibility for naming by turning it into this 75-year rotating clock thing where it's always up for grabs every so often. And I think what our conversation ultimately came down to was the idea that a lot of this hinges upon the type of leadership and the degree to which the leaders really own their responsibility in leading the conversation. And that as a leader, you know, it's one part of your job to try and listen to all the audiences and what all of them have to say. It's another piece of your job, and maybe a much harder one, to help your different constituents or groups understand what all of the other groups are trying to say, so that at least when, especially if you are completely responsible for that decision at the end of the day, so there's some transparency as to how you got to that decision and how and all of the different parties that are affected by it. And so then we chatted a bit about like what it means to be a leader that tries to help others see other perspectives, and the comment that the best leaders often make the comment that they trust the people under them. And that's one of the strongest traits.
Thank you so much, Simona. If we could move to group four, and I want to be mindful that we're almost out of time. So if the groups can just give like a quick wrap up, it will help. We might be a little bit over, so I apologize ahead of time. So group four.
Sure, we talked about the same topic as group three and touched on some of the same concerns, reflecting that the importance of the name of a building can change over time. But we also talked about not just sort of a rejection of a name because of discomfort, but also sort of reconnecting it to its indigenous history or the purpose of a place as being a positive reason for a name change. And that one of the problems that could come up with any of the name changes is that people might have a hard time finding their way physically or historically without some additional help in order to figure out what happened. And so similar to group three, we talked about having some kind of way of putting the name change or the name of the building in context. It might mitigate the need for changing the name if you could put it in context. And maybe that's a plaque or some other public representation. We didn't think there was up to one individual or the leader to solve. We talked about the importance of taking into account the views of various stakeholders. So that's a quick summary.
Thank you, Steve. Group five.
Yeah, anyone willing to jump in from the group? Okay, in the interest of time, then I'll start. And essentially, it was almost like there was a common thread. Everybody seemed to kind of come to the same themes here. The idea was this is about, the art, the piece of art that actually was could be offensive to some people, but what do you do in making a decision? So the suggestion was that the policy around discrimination and equity, et cetera, should have been outlined very clearly in advance. And if it wasn't in the contract, and if it's going to have this negative impact on people, then pay for it, but don't put it up. Check the possibilities in the contract, because if the contract really requires you to put it up, then put it up with explanation. There was sort of discussion on the Walker Arts Center and the scaffold example, and how that panned out and sort of revealed lack of inclusion and so on, and ultimately had to be uninstalled. Then there was this question of who's involved in the decision, the community, but also the artist, so even if the artist is representing themselves, they're also responding to the objectives of the client, in this case, the building space and so on as well. And it needs to meet the needs. And then there was a very thoughtful comment at the end where if the artist is using it as a way of teaching, then what is the goal and intention and thinking about that, because again, there's the issue of interpretation. Some things are offensive to some people and they're not to others. And so weighing those things as well. So thank you.
Thank you, Virajita. Group six.
Who's in group six?
Navin, you,
I'll be, my feeling about all this is that it just doesn't make sense. These are not ethical issues. Nobody talked about it, but to me, a politician is dealing with ethical issues, for instance. When he says or she says that if you put me in office, I will do certain things, and then just doesn't do it. I mean, that's an ethical issue. When you hire someone to do something, and as I said when we were talking, if you hire someone that you usually hire, if it's an artist or an architect, you hire someone whose work that you know. And we had, I think it was Sharon was her name, that she had done paintings before that had nudes in them. And then she presented one and was had a backlash to this. And to me, that's not an ethical issue. It's you when somebody hires you to do a commission, and they you've done certain kind of work in the past. I don't understand what ethics have to do with this. If you do the same, if you do similar work going forward, it means that somebody made a mistake. If they didn't like it, they made a mistake by retaining you in the first place. So I'll be asked, most of what I heard had very little, some of it not, but had very little to do with ethics. It had to do with, you know, the ethics to me are as if somebody makes a deal to do something, and then people agree to it and then don't do it, that is an ethical issue that has to be discussed. But if there's a contract to do something and they don't do it, then is that an ethical issue or is that a legal issue? I don't know. It's just it's an interesting question. And I was just a little confused by all of it. So if somebody else in breakout room six, we had some interesting things mentioned, and you know, I'd like to hear them again. Renaming a building. I mean, if someone gives money, if I gave money to put my name on a building, I mean, if it were me, I'd say, well, I want my name to be on there for either in perpetuity, or I want it on there for 50 years, and then you don't take it off until 50 years, and then that's an ethical issue. But other than that, it's just with personal choice or group choice. It's not ethics. That's my feel.
Very quickly, maybe group 7 and 8, and we can wrap up.
I don't think there were 7 and 8.
Oh, we didn't have 7 and 8. We had 6 groups. Okay. Thank you, everyone. I don't know. I'll just have Al and Tom and Virajita just give any closing thoughts they have. And
I just thanks everyone for the conversation. Yeah. Appreciate your attending.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, we'll share meeting notes with everyone that attended. We always send out a wrap-up notes and slides. So expect that email from Laurie sometime soon. Thank you so much, everyone.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you all.
Bye-bye.
Bye.